Hi everyone, this is Trevor from astrobackyard.com. I'm just sitting here in my garage. It is a Wednesday night. I'm going to be setting up this rig for some deep sky astrophotography shortly. But the purpose of this video is to review the ZWO ASI294MC Pro. If you haven't already seen it in a number of videos that I've shot, the 294MC Pro is a one-shot color dedicated astronomy camera. This camera was lent to me from Ontario Telescope and Accessories for review. I've had the opportunity to use this camera for the last 6 months through a number of telescopes. I've used it from a dark sky site and mostly here in the backyard. I've used it with a number of filters, varying focal lengths of telescopes, so I really feel like I've got a good idea for what this camera is capable of. So in this video, I'll tell you what I like about it, what I don't like, the specs, comparable models in this ASI range, and what's the other thing? Oh, my image results, of course. I've captured a lot of images with this camera, so I'll share those so you can get a better idea of what to expect with this camera. There's also a link in the description for my full article review on this camera on astrobackyard.com, so if you need some more information, go there. What I can tell you right off the bat is this is easily one of the best color cameras I've ever used for deep sky astrophotography. Before I go any further, check out the photo of the Trifid Nebula I was able to capture under dark skies using the 294MC Pro. The filter I used in the camera for this shot was an Astromania luminance filter, a very inexpensive filter that basically just acted as an IR cut. So no light pollution filter, no narrowband, anything. This is the true color that you can expect out of this camera and its RGGB sensor. The color images that I shot from the backyard using my light pollution filter aren't necessarily such a great test of what the color qualities of this camera, because I have to bring it back through all the, you know, heavy light pollution and the browns and the reds of a light polluted night sky, but that photo of the Trifid Nebula is a real great example of what the true capabilities of this camera are under the right conditions. Here in my backyard in the city, it's generally a light pollution filter, the Bader Moon and Sky Glow neodymium filter for my color broadband images, and then I've been using the STC Optical Astro Dual Narrowband filter, which collects both HA and O3 at the same time. That's just an incredible filter to use with a color camera like this. So because of internal cooling that this camera has, I can set it to go 35 degrees below ambient temperature. So on a hot, say a 20 to 25 degree night, I can bring it down to -10, -10, -15. The importance for that cooling when you're shooting narrowband is you can shoot long, like 6, 7, 10 minute exposures with that narrowband filter on, and it's just collecting more and more signal on your target. That's a great example of something that's just not possible to do with a color DSLR or an uncooled camera. 10 minute exposures are out of the question due to noise. It would just be a big noisy mess. So even though it is a color camera, it works exceptionally well for narrowband imaging. Yes, you're not getting that strong signal the way you would with a mono camera, but the cooling makes up for it, and you can just shoot longer and more subs to make up the time. I don't currently use a filter wheel either, so the way I've been constructing my images is to shoot the broadband color through a light pollution filter, and then layer in Photoshop the narrowband details using the STC Duo Narrowband filter. You don't need to use an expensive filter that captures HA and O3 at the same time. If you happen to have just a hydrogen alpha filter, that's probably the most important one and one you'd want to start with this camera anyways. But it's nice to get that added O3 in the Duo Narrowband. The 294MC Pro houses a highly sensitive Sony IMX294 CMOS color sensor. The Bayer pattern is RGGB. The sensor size is 4/3, so that puts out a native resolution of just over 4,000 by almost 3,000 pixels. As I said, it's got a cooling system, so two-stage tech cooling, capable of going -35 degrees below ambient temperature. As you can see, there's a USB 3.0 port on the back to connect the camera, and then a 12 volt power supply that it actually doesn't come with a 12 volt power supply, but if you're anything like me, you probably have a bunch of those lying around. So that's what's needed to run the cooler. So this is about where you can expect to have to back focus your telescope with this camera if it's a similar focal length and f ratio as the ED102 here, which is 714 and f6. So as you can see, I've got the extender tube on the back here, and then of course the space between the flattener and the camera itself. So all the way back here, this is pretty much right on focus from the last time I was imaging with this configuration. Now I'll show you what it's like to connect one of these cameras for a night of imaging. If you're used to a DSLR, it is a bit different, but it's, you know, pretty painless once you get used to it. So for those that have seen my rigs before, it might look a little bit different. I've got some Pegasus Astro gear on here. This is the dual motor focus controller. And then the stepper motor kit, which I got earlier this year. And then I've also got a mini pocket power box on the other side. I'll be covering this stuff later, but I just thought I'd point it out as to why it's all kind of crazy looking here. And I certainly need to get the wires sorted out, and I'm actually looking forward to it. So all these cables go into a four-port USB port down here. So what all this does is allows me to plug a single USB into my my laptop here, and then one power cord. So the power cord and the USB going into the power box, and it controlling absolutely everything else. So this power cord here is plugging into the back of the ASI294, and the little red light turns on because it's on. And then it's the next one up is the USB 3.0 cable, which we will plug into the back. So now the camera is connected to the USB port, and then it's just this one little cord that goes into the laptop itself, which looks like it's a little too far away. Oh, it's got a little divot. There we go. All right, so we'll get this plugged into the USB 3.0 port of my laptop. I'm going to first open up Astrophotography Tool, and that is the camera control software I prefer to use with dedicated astronomy cameras like this one. You can also run DSLR cameras with this software. And I'm still kind of getting everything set up on this new laptop, so I haven't even entered in my coordinates yet. It's that new. So it's auto-connected to the camera because I've went through this before, but just so you can see how it's done, I'll do it for the first time. So you shift-click connect, and then that's going to let you pick the camera type that you have. If you've connected a DSLR before, it's going to be up here, Canon EOS camera. As far as APT is concerned, this is a CCD camera. Using the ASCOM platform. So we're going to connect. And then here from the ASCOM camera chooser, because I've installed the appropriate drivers for the ASI camera, which was a pretty painless process, I can choose ASI camera 1 from the drop down. And then in the properties, this is where you'll set your gain and your gain control. So unity gain is the preferred setting that I like to use with this camera. So if you have it too, I would start with unity gain first. Don't mess around with the custom gain controls just yet. Try unity gain. The camera's connected. The bare pattern is shown there, RGGB, which is important. So the gain for unity gain is at 120, and I'm going to say OK. And then that is connected. And so now it will actually tell us the temperature of the sensor currently. And the first thing I like to do is start the cooling aid. It's 22 degrees, that sensor right now, and I'm going to set it to minus 20. Actually, I'm going to go to minus 25 because it's supposed to get on to 14 degrees tonight, which is the coldest it's been in probably about almost 3 months. Very hot summer here in Ontario. So this can be a slow process, the cooling aid. It can take anywhere from 5 to 15 minutes, and you can get more aggressive with how fast it goes. There's that cooling step that you choose there. I've got it set to 3 degrees at a time. with a timeout of 300 seconds, which just means that after 5 minutes of trying to get colder, if it can't, it just stops. So I'm going to reset up everything outside, and then I'll check back in with kind of the live view, what you can expect to see with this camera. Look at that big old bright moon out there. Try not to trip over anything. I just wanted to bring you out to the rig here to show you something. I asked my wife earlier today what target she wanted me to shoot, whether it should be the North American Nebula or the Dumbbell Nebula. And she picked the North American Nebula, so of course I'm shooting the Dumbbell. And this is a 3 second live loop through the ASI294 of the Dumbbell with a narrowband filter installed. So, as you can see, it just jumps out. So when you want to frame up your target, certain nebulae like this one, you're seeing it in real time in a 3 second loop. I could even see it in a 1 second loop. So it's really handy. I've got the cooler going in the background, and I'm just going to move this target right into the center of the frame. Some passing clouds go by, but man, look how bright that nebula is with that, I think it's like a 75% illuminated moon. So I'll just center this. I remember in the DSLR days, I was just so happy for the DSO to show up in my image frame after so many test shots. Wherever it lied, I would just leave it there and start shooting, because I didn't want to mess around any longer trying to find the target. But since I started using these dedicated astronomy cameras, framing the target has just become so much more enjoyable, and I actually take the time to center it now. So here's the Dumbbell Nebula in the center of the frame through the ASI 294 Pro, and I'll share this image captured tonight at the end of the video, as long as these clouds vamoose. Okay, it is time for the Astro Backyard final review of the ASI 294 MC Pro color camera. What do I like about this camera? I loved the noise-free images that it captures. We've had an extremely hot summer here in southern Ontario with 30 degree nights, and you wouldn't know it in my images here in the city because that sensor stays icy cold, minus 10, minus 15. And the images just are free of noise. They're an absolute pleasure to process. Even if I just get a stack of, say, a half hour or an hour's worth of images, say a stack of 3 minute subs, there's virtually no noise in those images. It's just an incredible feat. I mean, that's more something that I love about cooled cameras in general, as opposed to specifically the ASI 294. I'll say that the pixel scale, the sensor size is absolutely perfect. If you want a wide field refractor, like the ones similar to that I use, so from 714 to 1000 millimeters, just a perfect pixel scale for some of the best deep sky objects. The Eagle Nebula, the Swan Nebula, Trifid, even if you just want to isolate the Cygnus Wall in the North American Nebula, the Dumbbell Nebula that I'm shooting right now, such a versatile pixel scale. And so object size is, you can't beat it. That 10.7 megapixel sensor with a wide field APO refractor. So awesome fit. Another thing I love is that how well this camera performs with narrow band filters. I'm just blown away at the amount of detail and signal it picks up. Despite being a color camera, it just works so amazingly well with narrow band filters in front of it. So if you're in a similar situation to me, you're in town with a lot of light pollution, shoot those color images with a light pollution filter on moonless nights, get a hydrogen alpha filter and shoot some HA on those moonlit nights, combine them together for a real striking image of, you know, many deep sky objects. Probably the emission nebulae in the summer are the best example.
I like how easy it is to frame and focus my target. It shows up right away, even in a short exposure. I like being able to use a Batinoff mask with an HA filter on the camera. And just to be even able to find my DSOs in a short exposure with an HA filter in front, it's something you just can't do easily on a DSLR. What don't I like about this camera? It takes a while to cool down. Sometimes you're waiting 10 to 15 minutes. Right now it's at -6.3. It's slowly making its way down. It's a slow process, so you have to get used to that. The other thing is you have to get used to all the extra cables involved with the camera. It's another power cord. It's a USB 3.0 cord, which doesn't sound like a lot for some of you guys, but if you're switching from a DSLR with nothing, then it does. The other thing is you're switching file formats. Now you're dealing with .fits files that your Photoshop can't do anything with on their own, nor can you even preview them. You need to stack them in Deep Sky Stacker to debayer them before you can even look at them. It's basically everything that comes with switching to a dedicated astronomy camera. Those are the faults with the ASI294. If you can get over that stuff, it's an excellent camera.
Thank you guys so much for all the support. Almost 30,000 subscribers now. I cannot believe it. Big things are happening. Thank you so much for coming along for the ride. I hope you don't think these reviews are commercials. I'm just sharing things as I go along. It's a lot of work, and I'm just so happy to share it with you all. So thank you so much.
Okay, let's see. Rudy, you gotta say hello to everybody. Come on. Come here. Rudy, come here. There's a good boy. Yes. Okay. Rudy, sit. Sit.
Good boy. I almost forgot. Please sign up for my email newsletter. There's a link in the description. That'll keep you up to date with all the latest posts on Astro Backyard and everything that's going on, and maybe even what's going on with Rudy. Thanks so much, everybody.